From how we would get there to how we would make life sustainable, join me as we explore the plans out there right now to colonize Mars. Number 9. The desire. If humanity has taught us anything over the years, it's that if they don't have the desire to do anything, they won't do it. Yet for whatever reason, good or bad, when it comes to the idea of colonizing Mars, humanity has had an itch for it for some time. You could argue that this started all the way back in 1969 when man first landed on the moon, an accolade of which that we just celebrated its 50th anniversary for. So to many, if we could surmount the impossible mission to go to the moon, why was Mars such an impossible task? Fast forward 5 decades, and you'll find that many people are still thinking about going to Mars. And more than that, it's not just the governments of the world that are aiming to get people on the red planet. It's the private sector as well who are aiming high. People like Elon Musk are making their own plans to colonize Mars, thus putting us ahead of places like NASA, who don't have the funding that they used to. One could argue that humanity right now could use something like a Mars landing to galvanize the human race into being more unified. And if that isn't a desire shared by many, I don't know what is. So hopefully that helps explain part of why Mars is such an interesting destination to go to. 8. How would we get there? That is the question, isn't it? After all, if traveling to Mars was easy, we would have done it by now. When in fact, traveling to Mars is rather hard on its best days. Think about it like this. While Earth and Mars are technically neighbors, their distances apart is anywhere from 225 to 401 million kilometers away. It just depends on the day and part of the year they are in their orbits around the Sun, as they move at different speeds around the star. Because of this distance, if you convert the Mars distance to miles, you'll see that to travel to the Sun is actually 2.5 times easier than it would be to travel to Mars in terms of distance. Comparing Mars travel to the Moon travel, that's 986 times farther. That's quite a distance, and with our current technology, that travel would be on the average a year, give or take, depending on how big the ship is, the passengers, weight, and more. If you're a movie buff, you'll be reminded of the film The Martian, where an astronaut is left on the planet and his friends have to travel from Earth to Mars to get him. It took a very long time, and their ship was specially built to make that trip. At present, humanity has only built probes and satellites and rovers that have gone to Mars. However, this is changing, and changing quickly. The SpaceX program is preparing their own colonization of Mars, and to start this off, they're sending cargo ships to the Red Planet via their big Falcon rocket. They're truly preparing this right now, and aim to launch the first of these cargo ships in 2022. And once those touch down, they'll send out the first wave of colonists in 2024. Now, obviously, since it's still 2019 at present, that means things could change, and the technology could hit a breakthrough that allows them to get to Mars even faster. But the point we need to make here is that these BFRs are the best chance we have of getting to Mars in a good period of time with people on them. And once that happens, the colonization can begin. Number 7. Where to land on Mars? Once you get over the question of how do we land on Mars, the next question that needs to be asked is, where do we land on Mars? After all, landing in a key position, one that can help sustain the life of the colonists, is vital. Think of it in this context. If you were human and tried to colonize Earth, would you land in a desert or in the middle of the ocean with no land for miles? No, you wouldn't. And while the red planet we call Mars may look like a uniform piece of rock, it's not the case. There are good areas and bad areas to land. Scientists have deduced that the best place for everyone to land is near one of the poles of the planet. If you're thinking about our own poles and how cold it is there, you might wonder why they would choose there. It's simple. While it is cold there, that's what we need. Because near these poles is ice, specifically ice deposits that have been untouched for many thousands of years, if not more. We need water to survive, especially on a planet that doesn't have oceans like Mars. So, if these ice deposits can be broken into, extracted, and converted into liquid water, a major hurdle of colonization can be overcome in relatively no time flat. This would also help lighten the load of sorts in regards to the food and liquid supplies that would come with the colonists. So, location is important, but that's still only one part of the equation. Before we continue exploring Mars, be sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel so you don't miss our weekly videos. 6. Where would we live on Mars? There's a lot of differences between Mars and Earth, but without a doubt, the biggest difference is the atmosphere. Mainly, Mars doesn't have one. So, because of that, the planet isn't shielded from the sun's radiation or just the regular radiation of space that our Earth shields us from most times. Also, since there is no atmosphere to keep things out, that also means there's no oxygen to keep the gases in. Meaning, no oxygen, no carbon dioxide, nothing. Due to this, when we colonize Mars, we would need to have a base that would allow us to not just breathe, but also protect us from all the effects of the harsh Martian landscape and ensure that we can live without the need for spacesuits. SpaceX is working on that as well. Their plan is to have a singular massive base to start the colonization with. The base itself will be 41 feet tall, 16 feet wide, and have 3 different airlocks that will allow the colonists to go from the inside to the outside with minimal change in air pressure. It's stated that the initial team of colonists would be about 6 people, which is fair for a first attempt at surviving on Mars. Obviously, you can't just start off with a large city. If it proves successful, though, and there are no serious issues with the base in terms of air pressure, longevity, and more, more bases could be sent. Ones that could connect to each other via pressure tubes, not unlike various sci-fi shows and movies have shown. Slowly but surely, a vast space colony would be grown. Number 5. Powering the colony. One thing that might have slipped your mind when you thought about how we could colonize Mars is the power needed to power everything. While it's true that the first colonists would likely be outfitted with something to last them a lot of days and maybe years, and supply ships could bring in more things like batteries, you must also prepare for the worst. What if the main generator is struck by something in a freak accident? What happens if something from space causes the batteries to fail? What would be done then? The answer is in the plan. SpaceX intends to launch the colony with a series of reactors and generators. Some of them will be meant to specifically power the station itself, while others will be used to test making power based on the elements that are naturally and readily available on Mars. Thorium, for example, is one element they believe they can harness a great amount of power from. Believe it or not, this is actually a key element of truly colonizing an area, for it's easy to just go to a new place and bring along everything you think you need to survive. But to truly live there, you need to use the natural elements and resources around you. That way, you're not just living there, you're living there. And should multiple ways be found to use Mars' natural resources to power the colony, their ships, and more, it could lead to many advances and guides in regards to what happens when they return to Mars. 4. Multiple trips. Confused? It may seem odd to try and colonize Mars and then to leave it not long after landing down, right? But remember, colonization is a long-term goal, and the last thing you want to do is go to a plan and grow too fast and then have something terrible happen to you in the process. If you think about things like the colonization of the United States, that didn't start out with a massive movement of people. It started out with a couple of ships worth of people. And if you recall, the first colony didn't work out so well, but others did. That sent word that things were going well enough to bring more people over, the 13 colonies happened, and the rest is history. For Mars, it's kind of the same thing, just with a lot more distance. The first base is meant to ensure that colonization on the most basic levels is possible. To test out getting water, get the generators working, prove the living spaces work, and so on and so forth. The plan is for them to live on Mars for about 9 months. Then, after that, go back into their ship and head for home, which would be the first round trip from Mars in history. Number 3. Round 2. After they return to Earth, a bunch of research and tests will begin. After all, the now official colonists from Mars are the only real proof and evidence of life on Mars, so they'll need to be tested to see how they react to the return to Earth, how healthy they are, see if anything got on them sickness-wise, etc. All of this data will be vital to the second trip to Mars, where Elon Musk is planning to go even bigger this go-round. And by that time, the governments of the Earth will no doubt be helping out more as well. Anyway, the goal of the second mission will be to help not just expand the colony, but help expand the potential of the colony, including giving them more materials and equipment to work with as they try and truly establish an everlasting colony on Mars. One of the ways that Elon Musk and company intend to do that is via space cranes. No, really, he wants to make cranes that'll be able to go up into space, grab equipment from the shuttles that orbit it, and then bring it down to the research base so that the colonists can use it. This would allow more speedy travel and less work for the colonists themselves. Not to mention, it would allow for the transport of heavier materials without the fear of losing them during flight. Plus, the cranes will be reusable for some time, ensuring their worth. 2. Adjusting to life on Mars. Another thing that gets lost in the planning of going to a place like Mars is the issue of actually adjusting to life on Mars itself. Going from a rather open world like Earth, where you can move around rather quickly, to a place where you're going to be confined more times than not is quite a change. For the people who live on the International Space Station above Earth, they have to do rigorous exercise in order to ensure that their bones don't wither from the lack of gravity. Scientists aren't sure if Mars, which is smaller than Earth and technically has less gravity, will have the same effect on the people. Plus, there's the loneliness and confinement elements of everything, such as the fact that Earth is hundreds of millions of miles away and you won't be getting help from Earth if something goes wrong. The distance is so vast that it will take 20 minutes to send and receive a message from Earth. Add to that, the people around you are the ones you're going to be seeing day in and day out for the foreseeable future. That can weigh on a person rather heavily, especially if the crew aren't friends or know each other that well. And if you recall, the first base, and likely the second base, isn't that big. So you're in a small, confined area for months on end with the same people every day. So basically, it's Martian college without the dorm food. The psychological aspects of living life on Mars can't be discounted. In fact, they're a key part that many will analyze upon preparing for the second mission to Mars. Number 1. Expansion. But if all goes as planned, we're able to truly make multiple trips to Mars and start to colonize it, that changes everything. If the first base works, then we can start adding even more bases to the planet itself. Soon, we won't just have isolated bases, we'll have the makings of an interconnected town or a city. If the space cranes work, we can expand upon the surface in a way that's much more meaningful. We could make a base that is solely for growing food on the planet outside of the supplies given, or an extra area for the colonists to relax and do exercises in. And eventually, after enough work and tests are done, they could theoretically go and make a dome that would house the first true city of Mars. We're still a long way from that, well over a decade if we're lucky, but if the plan works, it's something we can most certainly dream about. Thanks for watching, everyone. What do you think about the current plans for going to Mars? Do you think they'll work, or do you think we have a long way to go yet? Let me know in the comments below, be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.